Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, dear Vice President of the Commission, dear Commissioner, distinguished members of the European Parliament, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. On behalf of the Wilfried Martens Center for European Studies, I would like to thank you for your presence to the event today. Given the high level speakers on our program, I will limit my introductory remarks to some thoughts on the enduring relevance of labor market reform for job creation and for economic growth in our home, in Europe. We all know that the level of employment is a key indicator of the level of activity taking place in an economy. Unfortunately, the recent crisis has shown that employment levels still exhibit national patterns within the EU. In December 2014, unemployment rates in the euro area ranged from a low of 4.8% in Germany to a high of nearly 26% in Greece. There can be no doubt that institutional factors are partly responsible for such divergences between national labor markets and that reforms are needed to address them. The study we are launching today, a unique collaborative effort between Siegfried Mureșan, the member of the European Parliament, and the Martens Center, looked in detail at the labor market dynamics of six EU member states. This research, by breaking out of the Brussels bubble and going directly to member states, identifies best practices and offers policy recommendations for improving EU employment levels. Let me just comment on one finding of this research, which I believe is of the utmost importance. We should not forget that the present crisis is not the single cause of Europe's long-standing unemployment issue. For example, youth unemployment levels were already approaching 20% in Greece, Portugal, Romania, and Belgium. All countries covered in this analysis in 2007. It means before the impact of the crisis began to be felt in European labor markets. In other words, Europe's unemployment problem runs much deeper than an unfavorable economic cycle and is rooted in an economic model that often gives special protection to privileged insiders at the expense of discriminated outsiders. Indeed, there is evidence that the crisis has finally acted as a wake-up call for member states to tackle their specific labor market weaknesses. Significant labor market reforms have been adopted in several countries. Although differing in scope and scale, these reforms are all based on the common principles of improving market flexibility while maintaining solidarity with those who are unemployed and seeking work. These principles are the right ones, and these reforms go in the right direction. I am particularly glad that Ireland was included in the scope of this research, as the wide-ranging economic reforms introduced by Prime Minister Kenny since 2011 have resulted in the steadily declining unemployment rate and one of the fastest growing economies in the EU in 2015. Reforms are often a major political challenge for democratic leaders, as they often reduce the privileges of important sectors of our societies and only yield their positive economic fruits in the long run. As a former prime minister of my home, of Slovakia, I was determined to implement ambitious reforms for my country. And I personally experienced how difficult it is to maintain a serious commitment to change. However, we must not allow difficulties to deter us, and we must always fulfill our duty to advocate for change and to act in the true long-term interest of our people. In this regard, my motto has always been that when you are committed to something, you accept no excuses, only results. As noted in this research, investment plans and structural reforms should not be viewed as separate policies to be utilized only in times of economic crisis, but rather as complementary tools that will create both growth and jobs in the long run. Dear friends, at this time, I would like to introduce our keynote speaker, a man whose political history and current role demonstrate his commitment to reform, and just as importantly, a commitment to balancing increased investment and budgetary responsibility. It is therefore with great pleasure that I give the floor to Jyrki Katainen, Commissioner Vice President with responsibility for jobs, growth, investment, and competitiveness. And no less significantly, a former finance minister, a former prime minister of Finland. And by the way, a long and very good friend of mine. There is only one occasion during which we are not so strong friends. It is when Slovakia plays its hockey game with Finland, which will take place, by the way, this Saturday in the Czech Republic as a part of the World Ice Hockey Championship. But I believe that regardless of the result, our friendship will continue beyond the horizon of this championship. And I wish you all the best to Finnish ice hockey team, but also to Vice President Katainen. And dear Jyrki, please, the floor is yours. Thank you very much.
Mr. President, dear friend Mikulas, Honorable Tommy Huhtanen, Honorable Member, and my good friend Sigrid Muresan, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for inviting me to this very topical event. I do want to congratulate Martha Center for raising this very important issue on the to the political discussion, because we are facing the situation where external world is challenging us at the moment. And this means that we have to be ready to reform our societies. We are not doing reforms for the sake of reforms, but we are doing reforms in order to change the way we are operating in order to get better society for our citizens in the future. As I said, external world is challenging us a lot, and that is the reason why we have to respond to these challenges. And we are not in the first time in the era in which we are forced to reform societies. We have reformed our societies constantly, but now, because of changes in the global market, because of changes in the digital trade, for instance, because of more integrated, more interconnected world, we are again forced to reform our societies. And reforms cannot be seen as a necessary bad thing. If you are not ready to reform your society, you don't care. So reforms are meant to be the building blocks for better and more prosperous society. Ladies and gentlemen, the employment situation in EU is improving gradually, but of course the speed is too slow. Positive economic sentiment and consumer confidence may indicate a good employment prospect ahead, but there are still some risks ahead of us. So we cannot rely on the cycles only. We have to go deeper and be ready to correct things in our society which are broken. Today there are around 24 million people out of work across Europe, and some 12 million people have been unemployed for more than 12 months. And this long-term unemployment risks becoming a structural phenomenon. Investment, jobs, and rebalancing the socio-economic agenda are necessary to give new impetus to the European project. Driving a job-rich recovery with better access to decent job is the absolute priority. The EU is building on investments, fiscal responsibility, and structural reform, undertaking action to support job creation and to make labour market more dynamic. With this aim, the process of labour market adjustment needs to continue, and ongoing reforms need to be implemented swiftly. I know by my own experience that reforms are usually more difficult to do than fiscal adjustment, even though it doesn't make any sense. But people are more willing to pay more taxes, they are willing to witness budgetary cuttings than willing to accept reforms to their everyday life. It, as I said, it doesn't make any sense, but this seems to be a global phenomenon. Budgetary cuttings or budgetary consolidation is important when you have to defend the credibility of your economy, but usually it doesn't create anything new, whereas structural reforms are meant to create something new and address directly to the external challenges. Our member states have embarked on a broad reform process of labour market inefficiencies, such as segmentation between permanent and temporary workers and rigidity in employment protection and wage setting. Investment is needed in skills, employability, and in social inclusion measures. The European semester process of economic policy coordination has proven to be an efficient vehicle to promote national debate and action on broad reform agenda. More than 185 recommendations have been given to member states over 2011-2014, touching upon labour market, education, and social issues. They have addressed structural reforms such as employment protection legislation and wage bargaining, active labour market policies, as well as vocational education and training regimes to social policy. It has also enabled the Commission to closely monitor labour market dynamics and policy development in the Member States, while establishing a forum of permanent exchange of views with governments, social partners, and other stakeholders. Overall, recommendations have been effective in promoting and speeding up reforms also in the fields of labour market in Member States. Since the beginning of economic and monetary union, there was clear awareness that a successful monetary union would require reforming labour markets to ease adjustment and to permit the correction of macroeconomic imbalances. Since the crisis, the need for such reforms has become urgent. Among the labour market reforms monitored in the European semester and other surveillance processes, we see more and more reforms on growth-supported labour taxation, employment protection frameworks favouring job creation and tackling segmentation, activation system incentivizing jobs and growth-friendly wage-setting frameworks. I want to point out that since 2011, the Commission has proposed also a large number of recommendations to member states in relation to issues which have helped member states to get better employment situation. A broad span of topics have been addressed, which could be roughly regrouped in three main blocks. First, structural reforms addressing core labor institutions. As I already mentioned, few of them, employment protection legislation, wage setting, etc. Also, measures to invest in skills and employability through active labor market policies, and measures of social protection and social investment. Overall, member states have positively reacted to these recommendations and the measures what the Commission has proposed. Of course, there are differences between the member states. Some have adopted new reforms better than the others. As part of the Commission's work program for 2015, the Commission will later this year present a set of initiatives with the objective of continuing promoting free movement of workers while at the same time helping member states to prevent and fight fraudulent or abusive behavior. This package will include a proposal for a possible revision of the Social Security Coordination Regulation and a report on any loopholes of the 1996 Posting of Workers Directive that could favor abusive practices or social dumping. The 2015 semester cycle will continue to foster reforms on the basis of a revised process geared to increase the involvement of social partners and stakeholders and focus on key priorities. Alongside the European semester, the Commission is developing important EU-level initiatives to flank national reforms with new ideas and policy tools, such as the youth guarantee, which is essentially a very important issue in many countries. As announced in the Commission Work Programme 2015, a labour mobility package is one of those. And other key objectives will come later. Many times, labour market reforms are seeing very negative things. Many people see labour market reforms as a negative change to what we have used to face. But if we explain that labour market reform could mean, for instance, better participation to working life for women, is that good or bad thing? Of course, if you want to incentivize women to participate to labour market more, you might have to do some changes to social subsidy, social security systems, or to taxation. Or if you want to reform pension system, which is sustainable, and for instance, pension age reflects the life expectancy, is it fair or unfair? I think it's fair. How about if you want to shorten the studying time in order to make it possible that young people can get to labor market earlier than they do at the moment? Is it negative or positive thing? I think it's completely positive thing. In this report, one of the most valuable part is the part in which authors quote what has been done in many of our member states. It gives a good opportunity to learn from the others. The Commission doesn't have power or competence in all of those issues which have been reformed in the member state level, but we can use this report as a source of copying and learning from the best practices. I just would like to highlight two interesting examples. In Ireland, the country and the new Enniskanny government in 2011 did a lot of reforms in labour market also. In 2011, Ireland launched Pathways to Work, a comprehensive plan integrating employment and income support services to favour the labour reinsertion of long-term unemployed. Over 26,000 people who had been long-term unemployed at the end of 2011 secured work by 2013. The number was more than 6,000 more than initial target. Another example comes from Portugal, where the new government did a huge amount of reforms, many of them very painful, many of them very unpopular, but many of them also bared very good fruit in social terms. In 2011 and 12, Portugal reduced high levels of severance pay and narrowed the definition of unfair dismissals. These were a major cause for the high occurrence of temporary contracts as a way to bypass the costs of permanent workers. Portugal also reduced the length of unemployment benefits, which was previously one of the most generous in Europe, from 38 months to 26 months, while extending eligibility also to some categories among the self-employed and reinforcing activation measures for benefit recipients. It's easy to understand that both of these examples have been highly critical, but as we see, the results have been encouraging. The only one who has benefited from the reforms have been a person who has got a job. So I would like to thank once more Martha Center and the authors for an excellent job. I also want to thank you for raising this very important topic on the agenda. I do hope that we could continue discussions even after this event and learn from each other. Look what the others have done successfully, and understand that reforms are always difficult. But once our priorities are right, if we want to prioritize job creation, opportunities to work, we must be ready to sacrifice part of our political convenience for the sake of better employment and for the sake of a more just world. Thank you very much.
Hello everybody, my name is Dr. Andre and I'm a research officer at the Martin Center. Commission Vice President Katainen has and Siegfried Muirsen MEP have kindly agreed to participate in a panel discussion for about 20-25 minutes, and then hopefully, if time allows, a short questions and answer session. Just a few housekeeping issues. This event is being live streamed on martincenter.eu. We're also on Twitter at Martin Center, and also feel free to complete the feedback forms which are available from the registration desk. I'd now like to welcome officially Siegfried Muirsen MEP. He's a Romanian EPP MEP. He is Vice Chair of the Budget Committee in the European Parliament, and he is a former Senior Political Advisor from EPP headquarters here in Brussels. I guess the question here is, after the Commissioner's address and after former Prime Minister Zorinda's address, is how to start the discussion, because there's so many issues to talk about. Perhaps I'll just provide a little context. The Commissioner mentioned the 24 million people currently unemployed in the European Union. To put that figure in greater context, that's over twice the population of Belgium. The situation for young people, particularly those under the age of 25, can be considerably worse. And it's important to know that even in this city, even in Brussels, within walking distance of this hotel, there are areas of this city with youth unemployment rates of between 40 and 50%. So it's not an issue that just affects, you know, peripheral countries like my own in Ireland or Romania or Portugal or Greece or Spain. It also affects practically all member states throughout the European Union. And when I was looking for some kind of, great context to put this argument in, I think I found the best with what Commission President Juncker said in his mission statement to the commissioners last year, which was when he said that the EU now lives with a 29th member, and that member comprises over 20 million unemployed people. So I think that's a key issue for us here today. And I suppose, as the Commissioner highlighted, the rationale for this event is to show that it's our job, as the Martin Centre, as the EPP, as the centre-right, not just to combat unemployment, but to provide a framework that will allow us to create jobs and growth in the future, not just for this year, but in 5 years' time and in 10 years' time. So with that, I'd like to start the discussion. Siegfried, if I could come to you first. I think there were two very interesting points in your analysis in the paper of the Romanian situation. The first was the relationship between the reform programs implemented in 2008-2009 and the current situation. And secondly is this issue of labour mobility. In Europe, in Brussels, we tend to think of it just in a European context. But actually, within Romania, it also has an internal concept, which is not just unique to Romania. So I was just wondering if you could comment on those two.
Yeah, of course. So also from my side, a warm welcome. And we're glad, Owen and myself, to see the huge interest vis-a-vis our paper. To move directly to your questions on both mobility and reforms, maybe to start with the one on reforms. As the Commissioner said before, too often we postpone reforms, we think of them as something as a necessary evil. So, of course, they have a negative connotation in the minds of too many people. And one of the consequences of this is that we do not do them during good economic times when, in fact, it's much easier to do them. We always postpone them. And so during hard economic times, there's no way around them and we need to do them. But both the economic and the social cost of them are, in fact, much easier to shoulder by the society, by the people, by the economy, by SMEs, if we do structural reforms in good economic times. And the reality in 28 member states of the Union shows that those countries which are today better off, best off, are the countries which reformed prior to the global economic and financial crisis. What happened in my country of origin, in Romania, was exactly the same. Romania joined the EU in 2007, so we had good economic times right before that and immediately afterwards. Investors coming in and so on. Unfortunately, we spent too much. The government spent too much. We did not do structural reforms. Wages in the public sector, pensions and so on increased more than the productivity increase. Therefore, the country lost the trust of the global financial markets 2009-2010 and it needed to both require financial assistance from the IMF and pursue structural economic reforms, which went, I think, into the right direction, like flexibility of labor markets, which I think is an essential issue. Too often do investors, do bankers in Europe tell me the main reason why we would not invest more in Europe is the rigid labor markets. We would be very reluctant to hire more people today, even if economic prospects are good, because we know it would be very difficult to lay them off and very costly if the economic situation worsens at some point in the future. So therefore, I think the flexibility of labor markets is a key issue for bringing definitely more people to the labor markets. But the question is also what comes afterwards. Many people ask, why is Germany so well off today? And part of the answer is, as also our study, our chapter on Germany shows, because of the labor market reforms 10, 12, 14 years ago. But the question is, what comes afterwards? Because through the flexible through the flexibilization of labor markets, more people find a job, but very often it's mini jobs, it's part-time jobs, it's temporary contracts, which definitely are all much better than being unemployed. But the question is, would this add up to enough of a pension to secure you your ages of retirement, or would that be enough to raise two kids to support a family? And that's why I'm absolutely an advocate of the flexibility of labor markets. I think it benefits all categories of society, young and old. I will explain immediately why. But the question is also what comes afterwards and what type of society do we want to create? And there in Germany, the answer was, including by our political family of the center-right, the introduction of minimum wage floors, but in a smart way, not an absolute minimum wage, which would endanger some sectors of the economy, some companies, and so on, but minimum wage floors differing from sector to sector, from region to region, based really on the purchase power there. So flexibility, I think, benefits all categories of population, because if those people who know that their job is secure and the likelihood of them being laid off is very small, they will not invest in lifelong learning. Their productivity and so on will not increase with time. Motivation and so on goes down, while you're having new generation of often very well-educated people who have difficulties in entering the labor markets. If economic times are good, if the markets are rigid, you won't hire more people because you would be afraid you can't fire them if you need to in the future, but you would just ask your current employees to do extra hours, which is not good for the company, it's not good for the current employee, and it keeps people outside waiting, so as unemployed. So to make a long story short, my home country also did some of the needed reforms during the tough economic crisis, which led to solid economic growth in 2012, 13, 14. We also discussed that in the book. But the reform process is something which should never stop. If you stop for 2 or 3 years, other countries in the region, in Europe and so on, will continue. And you know, it's like in sports, you will be lagging behind. So my call is also, I mean, do the reforms in good economic times and never stop. Even if figures will become good, what we tried to do in my home country was not to put too much of the burden on SMEs, not to reduce investments, because we understood that that would be essential for growth, for strengthening the economy and so on, investments. So we tried not to put the burden on the economy, on SMEs, but rather on consumption through increases of VAT and so on, which was tough for the people, but the negative long-term consequences were smaller, and it enabled the economy to return faster to growth than had we really put a huge burden on SMEs, on the real economy.
Thank you. And I think what's interesting, Siegfried, is just building on the Romanian example, is I think what the EU could learn from the different national experiences. And I think, Commissioner, if I could just ask you, it's going back in history, but I think it's as relevant today as it was 20 years ago, is maybe the lessons from the Finnish crisis from the early 90s, your own personal experience, the severity of the crisis, and kind of how the crisis resulted in reform and the impact that had on the Finnish economy in the long run.
Yeah, at the beginning of the 90s, I was a student, and at that time, Finland was more or less in a similar situation where Portugal has been during the last few years. We slightly, very narrowly avoided to go to IMF. There were several reasons. Banking sector went to crisis. Soviet Union collapsed, so part of our export collapsed. And also overspending was one of the reasons, and structures did not support dynamic economic growth. And at the time, the unemployment level was around 20% or a bit higher. And I mean, the atmosphere in a country was very depressive. Even my memories from this time when I was studying in the university, they are black and white. I cannot see colors there. It was so depressing. And me and my fellow students, we decided to study as long as possible because the university was the safest place to be. I mean, it was much better to study slowly than be unemployed somewhere. without doing anything, because we were 100% sure that we will never get a proper job. Then government did few structural reforms. First of all, they consolidated the budget around 10% per GDP, mostly by cutting. This consolidation was a structural reforms because the country couldn't afford to run the economy. So the spending structure must be changed. The second thing, at the same time when they were cutting, they started to invest first time in our history to research and development without any kind of evidence that this would create new growth. But they had just learned from somewhere that the future is knowledge-based economy, because even though nobody knew more about this, but they just wanted to invest in research and development. Third, they liberalized telecom sector. So basically, they created a new market. And fourth, they reformed corporate tax system so that once the corporates or the companies got profit, if you left the profit to the balance sheet, it was very lightly taxed. But if you took the profit out of the company as a dividend, then it was quite heavily taxed. So entrepreneurs wanted to leave the profits to the company, and they could afford to invest to the future. They could get some subsidies to R&D, and there was a new market. So basically, even though this is not exactly the labor market reform, the government did also some of those, but they reformed society from the very bottom and created, partially by accident, new basis for knowledge-based economy.
Thank you. It's interesting your description of your experience of Finland in the early 1990s. I think it compares directly with my experience of Ireland in 2008, 2009. And actually, there was a significant increase in Ireland in mature student applications to return to college during the crisis. And it's an issue that is not easily described unless you've lived in a country which has gone through a similar situation. Siegfried, just to come back to you, former Prime Minister Zorinda raised issues about how difficult it is to reform, how difficult it is to get the support for these labour market reforms. I think we only have to look at Belgium as an interesting example, the new federal government and their proposed, from my point of view as an Irish person, fairly, you know, basic standard labour market reforms. But the level of public opposition and vested interest that they're meeting. So I was just wondering, labour reforms in the EU only seem to happen in a crisis. Take Finland, take Romania, take Ireland. So I was just wondering if the new institutional framework that the EU has developed over the last couple of years, the European semester, as the Commissioner highlighted, do you think that will play kind of a further constructive role in the years ahead in kind of encouraging and facilitating member states to be braver to conduct these reforms?
Absolutely, yes. I mean, partly it definitely does. So the important point, I think, you know, in order to make labor markets work, the reforms which you need to do go much farther than just the flexibility of labor markets, pension reforms, and so on. Fiscal consolidation, to me, is an essential prerequisite. And to me, that doesn't mean cutting equally through all headers of the budget, but allocate the limited financial resources which our countries have to those areas which we believe make the economy stronger in the future, those areas which we label as priorities. Then, of course, because you also asked me about mobility, and I think there's a structural element there as well. You asked me about mobility in the first instance. We should definitely make mobility work in Europe. We're talking about that. But I think, and what we discuss in the book as well, is there still are some countries in which we have to make mobility work within the member state, in which there are significant discrepancies in terms of employment, and particularly youth employment, youth unemployment, from one region to another. And we just need to get the young people at the place where the jobs are. And there, partly, it's because of conservative societies that people go to school, graduate, buy a home, have a huge loan to the bank, get married, have two children, and then it's very hard to become mobile and to move to where the job is. So my thesis is, of course, we need to make mobility work within Europe. For that, very often it's bottlenecks. Like if I lose my job at a shipyard in Romania, how do I apply for a job at a shipyard in Finland or in Germany? What are the requirements? Which of my diplomas will be recognized, and so on? So very often it's just providing the right information in languages which many people in Europe speak in order for mobility to work within Europe from member state to member state. Then we also have to have it work within countries. And there I made a proposal to the government of my home country in December saying the following. We all know the program Erasmus for entrepreneurs at European level, which gives you the possibility to, if you're young and have a business idea, to do an internship with an already established entrepreneur in another member state of the Union with the European Union, the European Commissioning financing that. But of course, which is a good thing, and I want to see this program developed, but there is one prerequisite there. You have to move to a different country, which is a good thing. You can get to new ideas. But very often, some people would say, I'm not ready to move to a different country, out of various reasons. Maybe some would say, the most relevant entrepreneur from whom I can learn is established in my home country, plus I could learn things about the legal framework, about accounting, and so on. And so on in my home country, and therefore I would want such a program at national level financed by my own government, not requiring me to move to a different country. And I asked the government of my home country to try to establish and finance this and also stimulate mobility with such a program. So if an entrepreneur from an area with youth unemployment of 30% moves to an area with youth unemployment of 5%, you know, just support him with housing and so on. So make mobility work in Europe, eliminate the existing bottlenecks, make it also work within some of our member states, try to keep the brightest young people in Europe, because if, as a young person in Finland, you find a suitable job opportunity in Brussels or in London, you would move there, work there, acquire a new experience for 2-3 years, but if the framework is right in Finland, you would get back in 2 or 3 years. But if you're moving to Australia, New Zealand, Canada, or the US, the likelihood of you returning to Europe is much smaller. And there, of course, investment in research, innovation is essential to keep the brightest in Europe. And my last point is exchange best practices, because as you've all pointed out before, there are member states of the Union in which youth unemployment is particularly high, 50% or above in Greece, in Spain, 40% or above in Portugal, Italy, and then there's member states in which youth unemployment is particularly low, below 10% or close to 10%. Germany, Austria, Netherlands, Denmark, and so on. Let's see what worked in those countries. Not everything that worked in those countries can be transposed one-to-one in other countries, but say a dual vocational education system, which works in Germany and in Austria, of which investors who invest in the Spanish economy tell me we would feel the need of this, and we would be ready to contribute, including financially, to the education of young people so that they learn the things in school which are relevant for them to find a job and to work in our companies. But we need the governments to put the framework in place.
Thank you, Siegfried. And just to stay kind of, we'll just have time for one more question before we go to the floor, but I really can't let the two speakers leave without talking about education. And I was very happy to hear the Commissioner in his remarks talk about the structure of the education system in Europe and the length of time that students are allowed to stay in university. It's not always a particularly happy thing to say or an approach that gets a lot of approval. But it's very important, and I would urge everybody to read the Enderlein Pisani Ferry report on the French and German economies, which came out before Christmas, which mentioned this very point. But my real question to both panelists is, our study across all the member states we considered highlighted that there is a real emerging gap, particularly over, I think, the last decade, between the skills that young people are coming out of school, technical college, university, and the skills that are actually needed by employers in the labour market. And even in countries with, you know, relatively low unemployment rates like Germany and Austria, it's still an issue. So I was just wondering, are we really at the stage now that the Commissioner talked about before where we really need to embark on a reform process of the European education system? It's a very general question, but I think the education system is so linked with the employment issues, with unemployment, that we can't separate the two in this discussion.
It's actually, you cannot separate the two because the productivity, employment rate, profitability of companies, they all are related, and innovations or the creativity, they all are related to the quality of education. The EU is not only a free trade area, but it's also a union of values, and that's why we have to look what are the core elements when strengthening social dimension in the integration. Again, the European Parliament or the Commission doesn't have competence in social policy related issues that much. But nevertheless, we have to focus on the issues which creates the biggest differences between the member states in labor productivity, social justice, etc., and welfare. If I should choose one thing, if I was a dictator of Europe, I would force member states to improve the quality of teachers' education, teachers' training. Because if you look at the differences in productivity, in competitiveness, in employment, you can easily roll back to the quality of education. And when you go even a bit further, you can easily see the differences in the education or teacher's training. So this is a very core issue. There are lots of cultural things which create differences, but nevertheless, I have to focus on this. The second issue, and this is my final, there are three. Second is vocational training. You can get good results by using apprenticeships, as they are doing in Germany or Austria. It's a very good way to educate people. Or then there are also some good examples in more traditional or more school type of vocational training. I have followed very closely one of the systems, and there again, even in vocational training, the quality of teachers, vocational teachers, is very, very crucial and core point. And my final point is the role of universities. Traditionally, Europe has been very good in fundamental research, and also the universities have been very good in educating professionals like medical doctors or lawyers, etc. But the universities have not been the hubs for startup entrepreneurs. But now I can see very positive signs that many universities are changing. They are allowing entrepreneurs, venture capitalists to come to the campus, and they are working very closely with the private sector. So the research gets some relevance from innovation side. And when talking about innovations, you always need entrepreneur. And making it really a product and take the product to the market, you need financial system. So this is a positive change in Europe at the moment, which I see happening very clearly. And those are three points I would like to concentrate.
Siegfried, a final comment on education?
Just very briefly, maybe. I mean, to me, the answer to the question, you know, why do we not make more money, is very simple, because we are not more productive as employees, which is, of course, due to the poor education system. So, you know, do you want to make more money? At an individual level, you need to invest in yourself, learn an additional language, do an additional diploma. It's the same at the level of the economy. Do you want to, increase revenues, strengthen your economy, and so on? You need to do the reforms, which, you know, make you more attractive for investors. And I think, you know, when we're looking at the poor teaching at university in schools. Too often do we blame that completely on the, in many countries, on the low levels of payments of professors, of teachers. But I think, in fact, you're dotting the I. Very often it's we should invest in the training and improve their training. Too often do we believe that it's just the low salaries which makes the best people run away from universities, from schools, and so on. But I think, no, investing in their training is clearly part of a solution. And the last point is, yes, dual education, vocational education is clearly part of the solution now. Yes, universities are opening, entrepreneurs are ready to go there, but of course it's the government who needs to put the right framework in place. But my take is, in the long term, for the time being now, vocational education is part of the solution, but in the long term, we need more university graduates and university graduates of good quality. Do we want to face the challenges which you were speaking about at the very beginning of your remarks, of your introduction? Do we want to face the challenges put by the global economy? Do we want to be a leader in the knowledge-based economy? In the long term, we would need more university graduates and of good quality. But for the time being, clearly the vocational education is, I think, part of the solution.
Thank you, Siegfried. It's now approaching 4:05, so I think we'll open the floor to questions. Please raise your hands if you have a question and identify yourself. Victor, we have one here. And Roland here. And then the gentleman. We'll take three questions at a time. Okay. Roland, go first. Yeah.
Yes. I'm Roland Freudenstein, Deputy Director, Head of Research of the Martin Center, and you know, there's a huge temptation as a German to be self-congratulatory. But I would like to take a different tone here and say, well, first of all, as Christian Democrats or center-right people, we should be honest and say that the German reforms were carried out by a red-green government 10 years ago. And in fact, well, the red part of it paid dearly for it politically by actually, you know, creating the conditions for a more leftist political party. And maybe that traumatic experience is the reason for the fact that in the current grand coalition between Christian Democrats and Social Democrats in Berlin, there seems to be a huge hesitation to carry on with reform, to rest on our laurels, so to speak. And my question to the panel is, what would be, in an ideal world, the thing for the German government to follow up the successful reforms of the last decade to make these this success story actually sustainable for the future?
Victor, another gentleman here in front.
Thank you. Thomas Piller with the Walt Disney Company, and we are a supporter of the Martin Center. One question for the dictator, I mean the vice president, sorry, I'm always mixing up. But I should read newspaper more often, because obviously you had a promotion to dictator, I didn't know about it. We just committed 1 billion to Europe to expand our operations, and we hired a few thousand people for Park in Paris. Back to your point, Siegfried, we had the most problem with French law to hire non-French Europeans coming to work for our park in France because of the mobility issue, pension issue, social security, mobility and portability issues. We had trouble to hire people when there is so much unemployment, which is crazy. So, and it's getting better. In particular, young people from the eastern part of Europe wanted to come to us. It's just insane. But here's my question. In the US, the growth is starting, it's there. But now we're talking about the jobless recovery in the US. So if you put that into the European context, and you add the digitization of the economy, which is going to displace jobs, you know, and we love digital at Disney, but it is going to displace jobs before it creates new ones. How do you cope with the situation? So jobless recovery and digitization, which is going to displace jobs. How do you cope with those two factors, even if the crisis seems to finally recede in Europe and we see some, you know, green shoots of hope? Thank you.
Thank you. Pavlina, we'll take one more.
Thank you so much. My name is Dan Carbunar, I'm a Romanian journalist from CalEuropeană.ro, European Affairs website. I'm glad also that European Union is not run by under a dictatorship. And on these logics, I noticed, Your Excellency, Mr. Katainen, that two times you mentioned the fact that you cannot do this, you cannot do that, because it's on the member state. But you also mentioned the European semester as a framework to help the member states. A few weeks ago, the European Parliament published a report, and less than 10%, I think only 9% of your recommendations, the European Commission recommendations, are implementing in the member states. So everybody understands you want to help, but if we're talking about jobs and growing in economics, how can you be more convenient? I mean, how can you push the member states to do it, to create jobs and to share the good practices? And of course, the same question for Mr. Mureșan, as a member of European Parliament, if you can do, could do more to convince the member states to push the things further. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I think we'll start with the first question, the German experience. That is a subject that could be an entire session on its own right. Siegfried?
Look, I mean, too often the positive effects of reforms you will only see in the long term. And the political actors who pursue them do not get to the point to which they would reap the benefits. At some point, you know, you would see the positive effects and... But you won't get to capitalize on it before the next elections. That's why I think also for our political family of the center-right, I think it's essential that in those countries which will be holding elections over the next 1 year, which dared to do significant structural reforms, Spain, Portugal, Ireland, all rightly mentioned here, we are strong and active in communicating the needs of these reforms and the benefits, for some benefits which take eventually longer to be felt by the people. I think we should be very active in communicating this to the people, because if now, when all of Europe is looking to those countries and to the pro-European forces which did the reforms, if those political actors will implode now, then basically the likelihood that any other country pursues economic reforms in the short to medium term will be much decreased. And I think, you know, for the sake of Europe, this is something that we need to avoid. So be there, talk to the people, explain to them the benefits of reforms, even if sometimes it takes longer for them to feel them. But, and this brings me to the answer to your question, even if it's a jobless recovery, the jobs which are basically existing at an end of the reform process are more stable, and at the end of the day there's also premises that those jobs will be better paid in the future, maybe not right now, but if you're reforming, if the economy is competitive, attractive for investors and so on, they are much more likely to keep the investments there and stay. That's why even if in the beginning there's a jobless recovery, but if jobs are rather existing in areas which are better paid, add a higher value, digital and so on and so on, I wouldn't be worried in the first instance, because basically you are securing stable and well-paid jobs.
Commissioner, if I could come to you on the second question, the question about, you've got these companies ready to invest in Europe, ready to create significant amount of jobs. And it kind of coincides with the difficulty of, coming to terms with national employment legislation. And it also then mixes in with what Siegfried was just talking about, the impact of digitalization and jobless recovery. So is it a case of, you know, combating these issues one by one? Or is there an overall strategy that Europe should take? It's an impossible question, but...
Unfortunately, we still have severe shortages in harmonization of social security systems. You mentioned pension system, for instance, as in one example. And it's easy to understand that the lack of harmonization of social security system create barriers to employ people or go cross-border and get a job. So we have to continue in this line and try to identify the biggest barriers in social security systems which should be harmonized. You also mentioned that digitalization of the economy will destroy part of jobs and it has a negative impact. This may occur, but if I was very or ultra pragmatic, I would say that in many countries, aging is taking part of the problem because there is less people coming to labor market than going out. Unemployment is a severe problem in many of our member states. It's a personal problem for the person himself or herself, but it's an economic problem for the society. There's another side in the coin. For instance, my own country, 2010 was the first year when there were more people retiring than coming to labor market. So in medium and long term, our main problem is a lack of labor force. So if we want to get better quality of life, better welfare, it's better to invest to the areas which will help us to raise productivity. Because there are less people creating welfare, less people working, even if we had almost 100% employment rate. Still, we either have to work longer, significantly longer, or then we have to work longer and raise productivity. And there the labor market comes to the, and labor market policies comes to the picture. Because we cannot expect people to work 12 hours per day. Some of us is doing so, but not necessarily everybody. And we have to give people the feeling of certainty in their job. And it's better if the quality of the job is so good that people are happy and they can feel that they can influence the content of the job. So the labor market reform cannot only mean like whipping more and reducing salaries. It's a highly qualitative work. And there are very good examples in some of our member states. Then there are very bad examples. So it's not a black and white issue. We have to focus more than before to the quality of work and to flexibility, healthy flexibility of the work.
It's interesting, actually, that you mentioned the process of aging. I saw this morning the latest statistical release from the German Federal Statistics Agency, which comes back to the German question, which highlighted that the German population will decrease from about 80 million now to about 60, 65 million in 2060. So perhaps that's the real issue of reform for the German economy, is to reform their immigration systems to provide a suitable workforce for the future. There was one final question from the Romanian journalist on the low implementation of commission recommendations.
Yes, you are right. It's really a problem. And I do appreciate that the European Parliament pays attention to this issue. So from Commission side, we have to follow the reforms of member states more than before. We have been very strict with the fiscal measures and fiscal targets, which is very right. But now we have to focus more to structure side, because once we have achieved the credibility back and member states are doing quite, if not accommodative fiscal policy at the moment, or almost accommodative at the moment, they can afford to do it bit by bit, we have to focus on reforms or the structure side more than before. And that's why our duty as a commission is to follow that country-specific recommendation is really the member states are really doing so. But in many areas, we don't have a power to force. But in my previous job, I proposed within the prime ministers that we should use peer pressure more than before, naming and shaming. It's never easy to say to your good friend that, by the way, you have not reformed your pension system, even though you promised last year. But we just have to take this seriously, because many of the crises, the crises in many of our member states are structural in nature, not cyclical. So it's our duty, it's the Parliament's duty, and of course it's member states' duty.
Siegfried, do you want to give a Parliament kind of
viewpoint? No, basically just adding that, you know, there's no way around structural reforms, and everything that we've seen in terms of monetary policy from the European Central Bank trying to help us bridge the crisis, going towards the limit of their mandate and of what the treaty allows them to do, but not beyond, of course, in my opinion. So all of this is no replacement for structural reforms, which have to be done basically at national level. And we, from here, I mean, we can accompany the Commission does so. We, from the Parliament side, we're also trying to do our share, but it's at national level where that needs to take place. And there is no way around it if you want to strengthen your economy, to make it more competitive and more attractive for investors, because my belief is that it's not us, the public sector, which is creating the jobs, but the jobs are being created by the private sector, and our primary duty is to put at their disposal a framework which they trust, which they find healthy and attractive to invest in. That's the best recipe for job creation.
Okay, thank you. We just have two very short, quick questions. The first one came in on Twitter from Daniela Goldman for Siegfried, and the question was, is the quality of our universities really the problem, or is it that the university system doesn't promote practical, I suppose, a vocational element?
I think we partly discussed it, and I think it's clearly both. I mean, you're coming, Commissioner, from a country which ranks high in all of the rankings linked to education. Some other countries in Europe are ranking below, and that's why I say encourage us to exchange best practices, make universities cooperate in Europe. Not everything that works in Finland would work in Spain, but some of the things definitely would do, and clearly open the doors of the universities to cooperation with entrepreneurs, with the business sector. And as I said, I think that's an area where the public sector has a role to play in creating the right framework, because from the private sector side, we see more and more the readiness to engage, to contribute even financially. They see that as an essential condition for them to getting the graduates with the right skills after university.
And Commissioner, just one very, I'm going to abuse my position and ask one very quick question. Just ignoring the political implications, but do you feel that if Britain did choose to leave the European Union, do you think that would weaken the cause of those who promote more flexible labour markets in Europe?
I think as important as the labour market reforms are, I think this would be the smallest problem for UK and for Europe. So maybe you are right. They have been very vocal advocating flexible labor market. They have some good experiences there, but also some rather critical ones. But I'm working as a commissioner. I'm working very hard with UK in order to keep them in, because we need UK and UK needs Europe. I have never understood why somebody deliberately would give part of the power from their hands.
Thank you. And I'll just add that Ireland also needs the UK and Europe, which is important. Okay, at this point, I just want to thank Siegfried and Commission Vice President Katainen. I just want to take this opportunity to quickly thank former colleagues in the Martin Centre, Stefan de Court, whose idea was to develop this project, and Enda McNamara and Catherine O'Donovan. So how to sum up this event today? I'll just give four takeaways. One, it's vital to remember and to get out of the Brussels bubble occasionally, go into the member states and see what's actually happening on the ground. The second is that confronting vested interests, reforming labour markets is a long-term process, and it's not always politically acceptable in the short term. Thirdly, we have to understand that investment and reform, investment and budgetary discipline are not inconsistent with each other. They're actually same sides of the coin. And third, or lastly, I think we should acknowledge that we can't consider labour markets or labour market reform without considering things like education, digitalisation, the digital single market. And in that context, I'd like just to thank everybody again, thank everybody for coming, and to say that it's our job. And we will continue, certainly in the Martin Centre, to keep this on the agenda. It's our job as the EPP family, and I know Siegfried will do the same in the Parliament, not to become welded to the old labour market models, you know, that developed in the 50s and 60s, and, you know, that other political families seem loath to change, but actually to develop and expand these models to reflect the digital age and to reflect the experience of young people, which will be, you know, considerably different even from my experience or the experience of my parents. So thank you very much.